Before the war, Warsaw had the largest Jewish community in Europe. There were 350,000 Jews living there, 30% of the city's total population. After the German invasion of Poland in 1939, the Nazis began concentrating Polish Jews into ghettos. Warsaw Ghetto was the largest, with up to 400,000 people forced into a small area of the city, surrounded by a high brick wall. There was an average of 7 people per room, causing disease and starvation to become rampant.
We knew that times are tough, but we said Germans want us all dead, so we are not going to die. We are going to live. We are going to carry on. We won't give them that satisfaction. So we were knowing, being aware of the incredible poverty, when people, you couldn't carry anything, you know, when you went to buy something, you had to put it behind your coat, because if you carry a little parcel, it was snatched from your hands. And you saw, you know, children, you know, anyhow, you know the images. I don't want to start crying.
We start building the fences around us, and we all suddenly in a ghetto. No air, no in, with the guard at the post, at the gates. We saw every morning, we got up in the morning, we see dead corpses lying in the streets, covered up with a bit of paper, newspaper, other papers, and picking them up, the bodies. The next morning again you saw bodies lying, which died from a cold, from a hunger, a lot of them.
The ghetto was very crowded. We have a typhus. Yes. And all sicknesses, and I walk on the street and I saw dead people just being covered with a newspaper. I saw little children asking for food, and I realized what is happening.
I remember children, you know, starving, dying in the street, just being covered by newspapers and being taken away.
We really lived in fear. And there was a terrible, terrible hunger in Warsaw Ghetto. I remember going in the streets and the children, it was absolutely a sight that I'll never forget. The children were laying on the streets, swollen from hunger. Their bellies and their faces were absolutely swollen. And every morning when you walked in Warsaw, there were dead bodies laying in the street covered with newspaper.
I saw people walking before the uprising still was on, outside the ghetto for work. And I remember how the Germans, the SS, ordered them to sing. And I was wondering, how could they sing? They hardly walk. How could they sing? Must be, myself being Jewish, I thought it must be not so bad in the ghetto. And that's what they were doing. They were pushing Jewish people to sing to create an impression that it's not so bad.
I remember my mother telling me that the head of the Jewish committee committed suicide. You know, that was later on. And I asked my mother why, and she said that it's a very bad sign, you know, because probably, you know, that even tougher times are coming. You know, that really shocked me, you know, to the extent that I, you know, I was so angry. I asked my mother, why was I born at all?
By 1942, over 80,000 Jews had died of starvation or disease in the ghetto. The Nazis then changed their strategy from concentrating Jews to simply murdering them. Between July and September 1942, more than 200,000 people, mostly children, the elderly and the sick, were transported to their deaths in Treblinka.
But in 1942, you know, as the ghetto was getting smaller and smaller, and there was all the time placards on the walls that they want people to come to work voluntarily. They will get they will get bread, they will get blankets, they will get everything. All they have to do is come to the trains and they'll be sent to work and nothing will happen to them. And a lot of people weren't, because they were hungry and they were looking for a better life. And of course, these trains went to Treblinka.
Initially, I remember when the first news about it arrived, and it was, you know, that the Polish fellow who was going to Treblinka and back, you know, driving the transport,
right, yeah.
He said, I don't know what it is there, but the transport come empty, and then they deliver another load, and I come empty. Something evil must be going there. This is how it was reported in Polish underground press the first time. We didn't want to believe it.
I mean, you know, the Germans were saying that, you know, the people are going to resettlement, to resettlement camps and to work, you know, for them.
All the time, Germans did take men away, and so we did keep to ourselves not to go out a lot. But it was always less and less people, because the selection were more often.
You know, my father's idea was that we were going really that they were going to kill us.
And one day they came to our street and they said everybody must go down to a big place. And I was standing with my mother and my father was standing with my brother. And suddenly we saw how the Germans from far took away my brother from my father's hand. After all that selection, me and my father and my mother we came back home without my brother.
Remember that we're this proverbial Jewish humor, you know, which kept all Jews alive, you know, for so many centuries. I remember that there were so many decrees, and everything was punishable by death. So my mother used to say, we have an alternative. Either we are going to obey Germans and do whatever they want, and then we are going to put our heads, you know, to be chopped off, or we have to, you know, disobey them and to do illegal things and to risk a little, and to risk our head to be chopped off.
So we decided not to go to Lublin. We decided to go into hiding. We had meetings in hiding to discuss things, what to do. We belonged to the underground. We got some ammunition, guns and things which Poles used to supply them for, naturally for a lot of money.
Yeah.
We paid well for it,
yes.
But I supplied that.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And we're getting prepared to fight against the Germans.
On 19 April 1943, Passover Eve, the Germans surrounded the Warsaw Ghetto to begin its liquidation. This sparked stubborn Jewish resistance, but the uprisers were poorly armed. At the outset, most of the ghetto population fled into bunkers and attics.
We knew that the ghetto was going to be liquidated. We knew that a handful of people were left in the ghetto, that the population of nearly 500,000 was reduced to 40,000.
In 1943, it was Pesach time that the Judenrein started. Yes. My father said like this, Pesach is coming, and I would like to spend the Jewish holidays among Jewish people. And straight after the holidays, he said, we are going to go to work in Ogrodowa 29 and we'll never come back. We'll go to the bunker and then we will stay. But the Germans had different plans. The first day of Yom Tov, Pesach, they started the action. And in one stage, the manhole was open and we saw guns coming down the stairs. First we saw guns pointed towards the stairs and we saw that we thought to ourselves, well, this is it. The Germans have found us and come to get us. And there were the Jewish young people who were the Warsaw Ghetto uprisers.
It was like Atonement Day for us. That mounting flames of the Warsaw were just in front of us, you know, the end line.
You could hear the shooting and shooting and shooting all the time. And as I said, those young people came in, we couldn't believe our eyes, you know, young people. They were really young, 18, 19, 20, you know. And we looked at them and they said, we are fighting the Germans.
Outside the ghetto, there were swings. The playground for the children.
Yes.
So the Polish children used to put themselves on a swing and swing very high so they could see how the Jewish people are burning in the Jewish ghetto. And they were joking about it.
And we were terribly hungry. We didn't eat anything for the last 3 days. And we were sitting there and all of a sudden we heard this, you know, the German steps, you know, bang, bang, bang with their boots. And we all were all hiding under the feathers. Mm. And they came into the flat and they didn't find us and they went away and we thought, oh, we've been, you know, rescued, they have saved, they haven't found us. Half an hour later, the same thing happened. And we went again under feathers and somebody's leg was protruding and they found us and they said, get out, you know, with their guns lower down, get out, all of you, because we'll shoot. So we got out and actually, as it happens, it was a lucky thing because they marched, they put us to the wall, searched us, and they marched us down over the road to another house, in front of another house, and our house, we were hiding under the feathers, was in flames. In fact, one house after another was burning. They burned the whole street.
Until the Germans did start to throw bombs in every house to have all the Jewish people out. And really they took bomb at our place and the house did start to burn. So we did run from our hiding place up to upper floors, and I did jump from the fourth floor of our house, which was burning. Somehow, I don't know how it happened, that I was not even injured. And then I lost my parents, we did lost ourselves. And when I came down, the German did wait for us and put my hands up, and we have been sure that they will shoot us. But somehow they did not, they took us to Ochschlagplatz.
Well, I'm going to tell you something. If there is a hell at all, somewhere, Umschlagplatz was the hell. What they did in Umschlagplatz, it is absolutely unbelievable. The brutality, the way they killed people at random. You know, they made us sit on the floor, and every few minutes they would come and demand gold and jewelry, and people would take off their rings, whatever they had left, mm-hmm. and put it in a blanket. They were raping women in front of everybody.
Yes.
They were beating people up, and there was a lot of Lithuanians and a lot of Ukrainians in black uniforms. They were the worst. And people were actually jumping from the, women were jumping, committing suicide from the windows. They didn't want to be, you know, raped or anything. They took my mother into a cubicle and beat her up. They took my father and beat him up. And I can't even describe to you, because words cannot describe what they did to us in Umschlagplatz.
I knew that it was like an end of, I wouldn't say my life, because I was alive, but I knew that it was there.
The uprising lasted 27 days. During this time, the Nazis razed virtually the entire ghetto. By 16 May, the ghetto lay in ruins and 13,000 Jews had died. Of the remaining 50,000, most were sent to their deaths in Treblinka, while some were sent to labour or concentration camps. News of the Jewish insurrection travelled to ghettos and camps across Poland. The Warsaw Ghetto Uprising inspired further resistance, including, most notably, uprisings in Treblinka, Sobibor and Auschwitz death camps.
But it was utterly unrealistic, and how they did it, it is, to me, this is a miracle. It really is. It is something that we should be so proud of.
Sure.